From the development of the steam engine and the inventions of the spinning jenny and the mechanical reaper in the 18th century, the first industrial revolution lasted nearly a full century. Enter the ability to harness electricity, the expansion of the railway, mass production, and the assembly line, and the second industrial revolution is said to last from about 1870 to 1914. Known as the information age or the digital age, the exact dates for the third industrial revolution are more difficult to define. It tends to be spoken about as beginning in the mid-20th century with start dates somewhere between 1947 and the mid-1950s, although as late as the 1970s and 80s is not unheard of. And the ending of it is even murkier. So it seems to be a date within the 2000s. That's the consensus, but definitely before the 2020 pandemic. The term Industry 4.0 was first used publicly at Hannover Messe in 2011 and refers to smart innovations revolutionizing manufacturing and industrial processes. We are living in the fourth industrial revolution right now, but the concept Industry 5.0 was already introduced by the European Commission in July 2020. Known as the techno-social revolution, Industry 5.0 shifts the paradigm of industrial systems design by emphasizing societal goals, including the well-being of industry workers. The coexistence of these two latest revolutions invites questions. So joining us today to explore some answers is Stephen Graham, Executive Vice President and General Manager of Hexagon Nexus. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
So before we jump into those answers, why don't you briefly tell me about Hexagon Nexus and your role there?
Sure. So my role is to lead the development of Nexus. So Nexus is our cloud-based platform for manufacturing. It brings together all of the technology that we offer from the manufacturing intelligence division at Nexus, as well as technologies from any third-party suppliers. It's a completely open platform to enable us to build solutions to the challenges and problems that our customers face today.
So let's jump right in then. So what defines Industry 5.0 and how does it differentiate from Industry 4.0? And how does Hexagon envision the role of human workers in Industry 5.0 compared to previous industrial revolutions?
Yeah, okay, that's a good question. So, in the Industry 4.0 was and maybe is all about digitalization. It's about automation. It's about maximizing autonomy. It's about cyber physical systems and so on. The whole narrative around Industry 4.0 was about replacing people because people are expensive, right? It's that's kind of what Industry 4.0, the motivation, if you like, behind Industry 4.0. Industry 5.0, I see really as a maturation of that thinking rather than necessarily another industrial revolution. So, you talked about the third industrial revolution, which was clearly an evolution from the second industrial revolution. You needed production lines and processes in place before it was possible to kind of automate them. So, industry 3.0 clearly builds on 2.0. The relationship between 5.0 and 4.0 isn't like that, I think. I think what we're seeing is the recognition that 4.0, this idea of digitalization and autonomy for its kind of own sake, is a little bit naive. And what industry 5.0 is it puts people back in the center of the equation, which is where they need to be. Manufacturing is fundamentally a human-centric activity. It's about what we want as people in the societies that we live in. In the end, you can't replace that entirely by machinery and automation and automated artificial intelligence systems, whatever it might be. So I see Industry 5.0 very much as, like I say, a maturation of Industry 4.0. So for sure, take advantage of all of that digitalization, automation, cyber physical systems, all of that technology, but to recognize that people need to be back at the center of the whole thing.
So speaking of those people, what skills do the machine design engineers need to develop to adapt to these changes brought about by Industry 5.0? And in what ways will the responsibilities of them and industrial manufacturing evolve within this new Industry 5.0?
So looking specifically at machine design, I'd say there's a few layers here to think about. I mean, the first one is that all of the mechanical skills to design machines and so on are still extremely relevant. I mean, the machines are fundamentally, they're still going to need to do the same job, whatever that might be. And for sure, there will be pressure on increasing speed, increasing accuracy, all of those kind of things. But those trends probably exist independently of Industry 4.0 or Industry 5.0. I think there'll be an increasing need for flexibility in machines. So machines that can sense, you know, more of what it is that they're doing. So the more sensor data that we can get off machines, the more that we can kind of do with that data. And then more flexibility within the machine itself. So more kind of actuation, more flexibility to move and operate in different ways in response to commands that are coming from whatever system or people that are controlling them. So I think there's definitely a need for greater sophistication in the machinery itself to enable that flexibility. And then finally, of course, the layer on top is all about software. And so the ability to connect to the machine, pull off all this data, analyze that data using artificial intelligence or whatever it might be, to then create feedback loops to then control and operate the machines in new ways. So I think, yeah, maybe in those three different levels.
So you're segueing perfectly into my next question. So how will the integration of advanced technologies like AI and robotics change the engineering, design, and manufacturing process?
You know, if I go back to the beginning and the Industry 5.0 thing, you know, Industry 5.0 is about putting people again at the center of it. I think the starting point is to improve collaboration amongst people, to kind of get engineers working together in a way that's more effective. So, you know, as we went through Industry 2.0, Industry 3.0, we created factories and manufacturing organizations that were necessarily very siloed. You know, different engineering disciplines had to be managed separately because they're very different. Processes were put in place in order to make, you know, throughout the development process and then also in the manufacturing process itself, processes were put in place to enable the kind of the automation and the efficiencies that came during those industrial revolutions. I think as we start thinking about Industry 5.0 and the way that we can leverage these new technologies going forward, I think the first problem to solve is to break those silos, create an environment where engineers kind of across the organization can collaborate with each other much more efficiently and much more effectively. And that's the way that we're going to drive innovation to kind of solve the next level of problems that we have. And then once all of that is in place, then we can kind of bring artificial intelligence in and all of these you know, more advanced technologies to kind of participate in the collaboration alongside the humans and give them superpowers, if you like, so that they can achieve a lot more than they would be able to do without those things.
Can we dive deep into the way that collaboration will happen? Do you want to talk to me about that?
I think there's big challenges around that. So, you know, engineers, organizations are siloed around engineering disciplines, and that's kind of the way that we've built these organizations. Because somebody that's working in design has a very different skill set, a very different history, and needs to work in a very different way to somebody working on the production floor, for example. They're two very different kinds of disciplines. You know, it's like the engineers in those different areas speak completely different languages. They use very different tools. They have a very different daily experience. And yet they need to collaborate in order to kind of lift us up to the next level to solve these problems. You know, I can comment on the way that we're trying to solve that problem. So, you know, with the Nexus platform, what we're trying to do is connect the tools that they use together to sort of meet the engineers where they are today, allow them to continue working with the tools that they have today. But in the background, create a connectivity between one set of tools and another set of tools to transfer data to improve visibility at both ends of that connection of what's going on and what the priorities are for the other party, and to put in place the tools that enable that kind of collaboration, and then try and present that data in a way that's familiar, you know, that fits the window that particular discipline is looking at the world. To drive that familiarity, improve understanding. And then once you're doing that, once you're transferring data, then you can interject things like artificial intelligence and other analytics tools into the mix to participate in that collaboration.
Yeah, you mentioned the learning. The machine learning is a big part of advanced manufacturing these days. And can you speak to that at all and Hexagon's role in it?
Machine learning is sort of one area of one of the technologies within artificial intelligence that we and many other suppliers are using. Our approach to that, like I say, is to bring it into a collaboration alongside engineers. And so what we encourage is kind of building collaborative workflows amongst engineers, and then bringing the AI tool in as a collaborator. And so, for example, specifically in the machines space, we have a technology that we're launching for autonomously programming CNC machines. So CAD model comes in, G-code comes out to then control the machine. It has an obvious immediate impact on productivity. Slightly less, obviously, it helps with knowledge gaps with new engineers kind of coming into the domain. But also beyond that, it changes the paradigm as well. It creates solutions to problems that seemed insoluble. So, for example, we have a lot of sort of small to medium sized machine shop customers who are really excited about this technology because they struggle with quoting. It's kind of one of their key challenges is they receive a CAD drawing from a customer and they've got to put a price on it. And because of the engineering that's involved to really understand what it's going to cost to make this part, pricing involves quite a lot of guesswork. They have to lean a lot on the tribal knowledge and experience of their team and that kind of thing. And it's a little bit of a gamble. And of course, you win some and you lose some. And the ones you win are the ones where you quote too low at the end of the day because you've gone in with the lowest price. So a huge challenge for machine shops. With an artificial intelligence tool that's capable of programming a machine and indeed doing many of the other tasks down the workflow, you can get to a much more realistic understanding of the of what it's going to take to build this part very quickly than if you just simply rely on the experience of the team. So it sort of directly solves that problem. So the point is that these AI tools, they're not only about improving productivity, which for sure they go directly to that, but it can be a change of paradigm as well. It can completely change the way you go about doing a task.